office.
Sworn in our office. We have come into this house.
Several
request that he really wants you to pray about. I think it was over the weekend or Saturday. One of our members passed. Let me pronounce it again. Felden Montgomery. Always just knew her as Dawn. And she always sat with Sister Pat right up here. And a young woman, 52. I believe she just passed away in her sleep. And so pray for Sister Pat, Sister Paul, Sister Perry, and the rest of the family. Kind of shocked. So pray for them. I know that Sister Pat today has to leave early, but please, if you can, she really needs, we really need to help Sister Pat out with some food today. And Sister Kinlow has the address or whatnot of Sister Pat's house, and it'll be included in the announcement. So if you can, they need help today.
And there are people coming over.
There are people coming over from out of town that they must be fed. So anything you can do to help that, we greatly appreciate it. We normally respond very well to things like that at this church. So please, we need you to respond on this one. So pray for me. It's a shocking thing. 52. I know when you're 18, that seems old, but that's very young. And to pass in your sleep, it reminds all of us, tomorrow's not promised.
Amen.
And none of us know when we're going to slip out of this temporal world into the eternity to come. And what has happened to Sister Montgomery is going to happen to all of us.
Amen.
It's just a matter of time. Amen.
Yes. Amen.
And only what you do for Christ is going to last. And the only way you can leave here and immediately open up your eyes consciously in His presence is to know Christ.
Amen.
As your Savior. Apart from that, there is no hope. So if you don't know the Lord, we encourage you to give your heart to Him. Today, some of us are trying to survive the rain from, I think, Wednesday, Thursday, a lot of rain. I believe in this county we had 2 inches fell in an hour, and my sun pump went out, amen? So I got up Friday morning, ankle deep in water, in the basin, and so the restoration people have been there. And they told me they need to get back in here Sunday afternoon, so I told them, well, I won't be out of church till such and such a time, so if I have to dash out, I'm not being rude, amen?
Amen.
I'm trying to save my base, amen? So I don't want to be full of black mold and drop head one day up here in the pulpit, amen?
Amen.
So I won't do what they say needs to be done. So that's minor compared to what others are going through, but a little inconvenience, and so we pray that they'll have that all prepared and done by Super Bowl Sunday. Let the men in the church somehow have to make up the gap, fill in the edge. So we all have to step in there, amen? Provide us a place, amen. Where we can do that man thing in Super Bowl Sunday. Let's go to the word of the Lord today. We are in Psalm 119, 41 through 48. Remember, we are reading this through this whole psalm because it praises God for the written scriptures He has given to us. And of course, our sermon series is Jesus and the Scriptures. And so we thought this psalm, which glorifies God because of the word He has given us, is most appropriate. So we're reading through this psalm in our prayer time. So let's begin at verse 41, Psalm number 119, and read through 48. Let's start reading.
May your love and kindness also come to me, O Lord. Your salvation according to your word. So I will have an answer from him who reproaches me, for I trust in your word. And do not take the word of truth uttered out of my mouth, for I wait for your ordinances. So I will keep your law continually forever and ever, and I will walk in your liberty, for I see your precepts. I will also speak of your testimonies before kings, and shall not be ashamed. I shall delight in the commandments which I love, and I shall live
gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord, we lift up Sister Pat, amen. Sister Perry, and the whole family.
Yes, Lord.
In the death of the loved one and a member of our church. And so we pray for them in this hour of shock and grief that you will sustain them.
Yes.
Lord, we pray for any today that do not know Jesus Christ as Savior. If you don't know the Lord, your sin separates you from God. And the only bridge between you and God, for the gap your sin has created, is a relationship with God's Son, Jesus Christ. And that relationship comes about by repentance of sin and faith in Jesus' death on the cross for your sins and burial, and his bodily resurrection from the dead. It is only through trust in him, clinging, active, living faith in him, that any of us can be saved. Lord, we pray for our country, we pray for our land. Lord, meet every request. Lord, according to your way, according to your will, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Now continue our worship service and song with the choir, adult choir coming to minister.
Yeah.
Teach accurately.
Come on, Doc.
His custom was not to hoop. He cut up and throw hankies and wear robes.
Well,
like James Brown. But his custom was to teach the word of the Lord. So, you know, this is a teaching church.
We're amen.
Do it like Jesus
amen.
Did. Amen.
Amen. Set the example.
Another sermon. Some Pharisees came up to Jesus testing him and began to question him whether it is lawful for a man to divorce a wife. And he answered and said to them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he, Moses, wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh.
Verse amen.
Read.
One therefore God is joined together. Let no man separate.
And God's people say amen.
Amen.
Amen. It is the word of the Lord. We are studying what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures. I use the word scriptures. I am speaking about Old and New Testaments. The reason why we are studying what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures is we who are orthodox in the Christian faith. What that means is we believe in the historic doctrine of the Christian faith given to the apostles by the risen Christ through the Holy Spirit and incorporated into those New Testament scriptures. And so we are orthodox. We believe the historic doctrine of the Christian faith. I mean, so the reason why we are studying this is we believe Jesus' view of the scriptures is the correct view. We also believe that what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures is the only view that counts among all the views of scriptures. Amen. We are studying what Jesus believed to be true concerning the scriptures because we want to make sure we believe the same thing Jesus believed about the scriptures. And the reason we believe Jesus is the only one who got absolutely correct concerning the scriptures is because Jesus claimed to be God in human flesh. To be more precise, Jesus claimed to be distinct in person from God the Father, but he also claimed to be one and the same kind as the Father. For they shared one and the same substance, attributes, and power, for they equally possessed one and the same thing. Which is the reason why God is God and we are not.
So amen.
Jesus and the Father, they are distinct in person, but they equally share one in the same substance, one in the same power, one in the same might. So I really want you to understand that. That does not mean Jesus has a power and the Father has a power. And there are two separate powers that are equal to one another. No, there is one power of God in both Christ and his Father equally share the same power and might. Yet the Son was in submission to the Father.
Amen.
Equal, but in submission to the Father.
Amen.
For example, in John 14:9-7. Jesus revealed to the disciples that to see him is the same as seeing God. Mm-hmm. The narrative reads as follows. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father. That is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you, and yet you have not come to know me, Philip? Mm-hmm. He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The word that I say to you, I do not speak on my own initiative, but the Father abiding in me, he does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Otherwise, believe because of the works themselves. And so when Jesus said, he who has see me is to see exactly who God is and what God is like, for he was in the Father and the Father was in him. In other words, they equally shared one and the same substance, essence, power, and might, and therefore all that Jesus did, the Father did, and all that the Father did, Jesus did. Jesus and the Father were separate in person, but they were equal in every way, eternally sharing one and the same essence, one and the same substance, one and the same power, one and the same might. But the Father was in Jesus, and Jesus was in the Father. They were inseparably one, although distinct in person. And so the proof that the Lord was God in human flesh was his resurrection from the dead. Romans 1 and 4, speaking of Christ, the text says, who was declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. According to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So the Lord says, he and the Father, he says, we are one. He declared to be equal to God. He claimed to be God. And the proof that his words were true is the Father raised him from the dead. And so the Lord Jesus Christ was God in human flesh. He was equal to God the Father in all things. The proof of this was the Father raised him from the dead. Therefore, Jesus was the God-man. And because he was God, all that he said was absolutely true. And so since the Lord Jesus Christ was God in human flesh, all he said was true because God cannot be wrong. Therefore, what he believed about the scriptures, it has to be the truth.
Amen.
Because God can never get it wrong.
Amen.
So in this series, we have discovered Jesus believed the following concerning the scriptures. Number one, he believed the scriptures came from the mouth of God. Matthew 4:4. Number two, he believed the scriptures were infused with the power of God. Matthew 4:1-11, Satan tempts him three times. Jesus put him on the run by quoting him the scriptures. Satan, the most powerful evil being in the universe, he could not stand up to the word of God quoted to him accurately because there is power in the words of God.
Amen.
The Lord believed the scriptures were inseparable from acceptable worship and sound doctrine. We read that in Mark 7. 1-8, if your worship is not saturated in the word of God, saturated with the word of God, the Lord said you are worshiping God in vain. If your doctrine is void of the Bible, but it's all what grandma said, then you are teaching in vain.
Mm-hmm.
Number four, the Lord believed the scriptures could be rendered to be of no effect in the lives of the people by man-made traditions. We studied all of that in Mark 7:9-13 last week. And that passage says he was saying to them, to the Pharisees, you are experts at setting aside the commandment of God in order to keep your tradition. But Moses said, honor your father and mother. And he who speaks evil of father and mother is to be put to death. But you say, if a man says to his father or mother, whatever I had that would have been help you is Corban, that is to say, given to God, you no longer permit him to do anything for his father or mother. Therefore, thus invalidating the word of God by your tradition, which you have handed down, and you do many things such as that. So, Pharisees taught, if you got a large sum of money, and you plan on using it to help your ailing, aging mother or father, you can't give that money to them because that money belongs to God. You got to give that into the temple treasury. So the Lord says, well, the Bible says, honor your father and mother. And so the Lord said, you through your tradition, you better put that money in that church offering. He said, through your tradition, you are nullifying the word of God that says, honor your father and mother. And what God meant was when they get to the point they can't take care of themselves, guess whose responsibility it is?
Amen.
And so the Lord says, you're not permitting the people to follow the command of God. You've invalidated the command of God by your traditions.
Mm-hmm.
and it was not written in the scriptures. They were the so-called sayings of the wise rabbis, who claimed to be able to see things beyond scripture that mere laymen could not. When our Lord stated these traditions invalidated the word of God, or they made the word of God of no effect, he was not saying these man-made traditions made the scripture cease to be the word of God. But when these various traditions were taught as if they were the word of God, they rendered the scriptures to have no control or lordship over the lives of the people. When you are following what Big Mama said, and Big Daddy said, and Deacon so-and-so, what he used to say and do, and Mother Bessie, she used to say this, and the preacher man used to say this, when you substitute that for the Bible, then you render the Bible to be of no effect in the lives of the people. Amen?
Amen.
Mother Bessie said you got to have a skirt on at least 3 inches below your knee. Well, the Bible doesn't say that. It says dress modestly.
Right.
And so don't give an inch. And so, you know, when you substitute that for the Bible says dress modestly, you're making the text that says dress modestly to be of no effect. Mm-hmm. And you're giving Big Mama's words more authority than God's words. Amen?
Amen. Amen. Come on, teach.
So there's a direct application of this today. Because in many circles, some probably within a 60, 65 mile radius of me today, the sayings of men are more valued than the words of God. They are more valued than the scriptures. This has made what God has spoken in his word to have no effect on the people. But listen, I know some folks, and I know what I'm going to say sounds like, Pastor Kinlow, you're not serious. Yes, I'm serious. I believe there are people, they're in church right now having a good time.
Well,
a party.
If Bishop or the pastor said, you know what God said, it's all right for you to steal in certain situations. Even though the Bible says thou shalt not steal.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you. You would open up your Bible to Exodus 20 and it says, wait a minute, the Bible says thou shalt not steal. And they'll say, well, but the bishop said on certain occasions, you can get you some stuff. Y'all think I'm playing? I don't know, but that hypnotized and that brainwashed by the bishop. But the voice of God be of no effect in the lives of the people because they want the people to obey them
well
rather than God.
Amen.
And so this morning, I want to move on and talk about the fact that Jesus believed the miracles and the scriptures to be literal and true.
Amen.
The Lord believed the miracles recorded in your Bible.
Mm-hmm.
That most men scoff at. He believed them to be true.
Amen.
The miracles that are written in your Bible that most people today think are myth. Metaphorical language. That's just symbolic language, Pastor. That's just an allegory. Jesus believed the miracles recorded in the Bible to be true.
Mm-hmm.
So let's take a look at this. Let me read Mark 10, 1 through 9 again. And it says, getting up, he went from there to the region of Judea. And beyond the Jordan, crowds gathered around him again. And according to his custom, he once more began to teach them. Some Pharisees came up to Jesus, testing him, and began to question him whether it was lawful for a man to divorce a wife. And he answered and said to them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. But Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, he wrote you this commandment. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, and the two shall become one flesh, so they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate.
Amen.
And so in this passage, Jesus was once again confronted by some of the same arch-enemies who are always confronting him in his earthly ministry. These, of course, were the Pharisees. These are the same group of men whom we saw in the last two sermons in Mark chapter 7, who criticized Jesus for not insisting that his disciples keep their various traditions of how to wash their hands and how to wash pots and pans. Now, I'm not going to go into the history of this group as I did in the last two sermons. If you heard them, you should have some idea of who these men were. But I will say once again, I'll tell you what our Lord stated about these men. And that is, he declared that they were all hypocrites who honored God with their lips. But the Lord said, your hearts are far away from God. The Lord said in Mark 7, 6-7, rightly did Isaiah prophesy to hypocrites, and it is written, this people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far away from me. But in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrine the precepts of men. And so we have in this Mark 10 text, the same group of religious hypocrites confronting the Lord once again in an attempt to outwit him. Trap him up in his words. Testing him. Tempting him. You know, you have some people who think they're smarter than God. You know, there are some people who think they're that sharp. Sharper than Jesus. Sharper than the Holy Spirit. Sharper than God the Father. How do I know that? God says, don't do this. But you think you can do it. And figure out a way to get around the consequence.
Come on, teach.
God says, if you do this, this is going to happen to you. But you're so smart that you figured out a way to do whatever you want to do in your life. In some kind of way, you are going to circumvent the consequences of sinful choices in your life. You know, some people, you're still trying to outwit God, and it'll never happen. Amen. God is infinite, and you're stupid. God knows all things. We know very little.
Amen.
I'm talking about as a whole, in comparison to God, we're all stupid.
Talk to me.
But some people think they can outwit God. A lot of Christians go outwit God. Think somehow you're going to manipulate God into blessing you. Apart from you, God says, if you do this, I will bless you. See, we're going to manipulate God to bless us when we don't do what God said, do this.
Jesus.
It's the truth.
And so here they are again, my outwit the Lord. And the subject in which they were trying to put Jesus to the test concerning a man divorcing his wife. It is possible or more probable that the reason why they tried to test our Lord concerning divorce was because of a statement Jesus had made in a previous sermon. We call it the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:31-32, in which the Lord said, it was said, whoever sends his wife away, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say unto you that everyone who divorces his wife except for the reason of unchastity, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now you have to understand what was taking place in this particular confrontation in order to fully appreciate the words of our Lord. You see, the Pharisees, as they did with many other subjects, they had developed a tradition concerning a man divorcing his wife. by misapplying or torturing Deuteronomy 24:1 to such an extent that they made it say what it did not say. They quoted part of Deuteronomy 24:1, but conveniently left a portion out. Because if they were to let that portion in, it would totally negate the way they were abusing this law of God.
Amen.
Deuteronomy 21:4, it fully says, when a man takes a wife and marries her, and it happens that she finds no favor in his eyes because he has found some indecency in her. And normally this was some kind of sexual impropriety, which did not include physical intercourse or, you know, physical sexual intercourse. So he had found some indecency in her. And he writes her a certificate of divorce and puts it in her hand and sends her out from his house. So the reason why we know that indecency that was found by a husband of his wife in this verse, we know that it was not speaking about physical sexual intercourse. Because if either a married man or woman committed physical sexual intercourse, there was no need for divorce. Because you died under a pile of rocks. Deuteronomy 22:22. If a man is found lying with a married woman, then both of them shall die. The man that lay with the woman, and the woman, thus you shall purge the evil from Israel. So this indiscretion that permitted a man to divorce his wife, it was not physical adultery, but some other kind of sensual, sexual indiscretion. I mean, nowadays we call it sexy.
Come on, tell the truth. Tell the truth. Perversion.
We got a long distance thing on so and so in Oregon. Y'all just sending each other dirty messages. Let me move on. Amen. Or some other thing. Flirting with some of your flirts. Flirts. Some of you being your flirts, you go too far. And I know I talk about modesty. You know, we all address modesty. But you know, you can walk up in here in such a way that the brothers cannot pay attention to the word of God. Am I in the house today? Because they looking at we men. Let's get real in here today. Amen.
Come on, cut it straight.
You know, we say, Bible believers, we as guys. Amen.
Amen.
And so, you know, you can commit a sexual indecency and not actually commit physical, sexual sin. So the Pharisees only quoted a section of that Deuteronomy 24 text, which said, write your wife a certificate of divorce and send her on her way. Mm-hmm. And they quoted this portion of Deuteronomy 21:24:1 in a wrong way. And they used it as an excuse to divorce a wife for any reason they deemed appropriate, while at the same time convincing themselves that they were scripturally justified in what they did. So they took a portion out. The context was, if you find your wife in some kind of indecency, then you can send her away. Now, they took that out. And for whatever reason they thought that they didn't like something, they would write her a bill of divorcement and send her on her way. Mm-hmm. My wife's cornbread stinks. You got to go. They write her a bill of divorce and send her on her way. The truth of the matter is, Deuteronomy 24:1, it only permitted divorce if a married woman was discovered to have committed some form of indiscretion outside of her marriage with another man, sexting, today it would be, you know, sending some other kind of provocative sensual messages, emotional affairs. Always after lunch, the same man or woman who is not your spouse. We're just good friends. You know, when you get married, your good friend is your spouse.
Amen.
Am I in the house?
Amen.
When you get married, you better make him your good friend. Amen. That's your ace boom coon. From this day till death do you part. Amen.
Amen. Cut a string.
So this is why the Lord said in Matthew 5:32. They said, you can send your wife away for anything. She burned the bread, get rid of her. She ain't looking as fly as she used to, get rid of her. And nobody looks as fly as they used to do, you know? When you're 60, you're not looking 30. I don't know. My wife ain't, you ain't here, amen. This ain't shape. You ain't shaped like you was when you was 22 either, amen. When's the last time you saw your ankles from a standing up position?
Amen. Talk to me.
Get rid of her for any reason. But the Lord said, but I say to you, that everyone who divorces his wife, except for the reason of unchastity, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. The Lord was not adding to the law of God when he said, but I say to you, but he was only stating what Deuteronomy 24 said when read accurately. That is, the only reason for a divorce is if a man caught a woman in a sexual indiscretion, not physical sexual sin, then that occurred. Now, when Jesus made this statement in Matthew 5:32, but I say unto you that everyone who divorces his wife except for the reason of unchastity makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a woman marries a divorced woman commits adultery, he had revealed the Pharisees who are teaching and practicing the twisted interpretation of Deuteronomy 24:1. Anytime your wife don't please you, get rid of her. He revealed that they were disobeying the very law they said they reverenced.
Yes.
And he revealed they were really leading others into adultery. And so it once again highlighted the Pharisees' hypocrisy. You claim to love the law of God, but you've taken certain portions out to make it say what you want to say. And the Lord says, when you do this, you are leading, you're in adultery, and you're leading others into adultery also. Needless to say, they didn't like the implications the Lord made against them. And so they approached him on this day in Matthew 10:2. Some Pharisees came up to Jesus testing him and began to question him whether it is lawful for a man to divorce a wife. In verse 3, the Lord responded to their question with a question. He said, well, what did Moses command you? That was a common way in Judaism, ancient Judaism. The common way of asking a question was to ask another question. And so he says, what did Moses command you? In verse 4, the Pharisees did the same thing they always did. They only quoted part of Deuteronomy 21:4. They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. They left out the one portion, if you catch her in an indecency.
Excellent, Pastor, excellent.
In verse 5, our Lord retorted, or strongly replied to the Pharisees, butcher job, on Deuteronomy 24:1, he said this, because of your hardness of heart, Moses wrote you this commandment. In essence, Jesus told these hypocrite Pharisees, the reason why Moses wrote that commandment because you guys have a hard heart. The phrase hardness of heart is a Greek word, sclerocardia. It means to be stubborn and obstinate. It indicates a person's stubbornness and obstinacy towards God in his grace. Now remember, the law in Deuteronomy permitted men to divorce a wife or writ a divorce because she committed some indiscretion of a nature which was not physical intercourse. Or simply, the woman did not commit a sexual indiscretion which incurred the death penalty. But because these men were so hard of heart towards God and his graciousness toward them, God knew they would never forgive their wives. Thus, the woman was given a certificate of divorce, which permitted her to get married again. But she could never be married again to the person who divorced her. You know, God knew there would be men who were so hard of heart, they would never be gracious toward their wives as God had been gracious towards them. Because they were hard at heart. Unforgiving. I'll never forgive you for what you did. Because they were hard of heart. God permitted the man to write a writ of divorce, and the woman could then get married again, but never to him. Why? Because God didn't want you to end up with hard heart again. Am I in the house tonight?
Come on, teach.
You understand what I'm saying? So really the law was written to benefit the woman.
Amen.
So she wouldn't be under you, hard head. Hard heart. Because, you know, men, I don't know what's wrong with us. You know, we can believe flirtatious. Roman eye. I didn't say Roman eye. Like a Roman, I say Roman eye. You sit out there at the food court at the mall and just eye candy all day.
Lust.
If you think you see your wife looking at a guy, what you doing? I saw you. What, you want it? You want it?
Cut it straight back.
You barely, you know, I think so and so had. What do you mean? Yes. See, God wrote the law to protect the woman from the hard-headed man. So, and she was free to never marry again, but it would go back and read it. But God said, never to you again.
Amen.
Because he didn't want this woman to get hooked up again with this hard-headed, hard-hearted, cold, unforgiving man who normally is full of lust himself.
Teach, Pastor.
And probably has committed adultery 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 times. Let me move on to that.
Come on, talk to us.
See, it gave the woman a chance to get married, have children, have a family. But at the same time, never again would she be entangled with you, with your hard heart. So in essence, this law was written for the benefit of the woman who had gotten hooked up to a hard-headed, unforgiving man. Now, I'm going to say something today. Because I'm going to get to Jesus in the scriptures. I know y'all wondering where I'm going. Don't worry.
No, teach us, teach us.
But you know, y'all, man, let me talk to y'all, man. You can spend a great part of your day in lust.
Mm-hmm. Preach that.
Come on, Doc.
I got one come on, Doc. Amen. You can spend a great part of your day in lust. Yeah. After every other woman you see on the street. Mm-hmm. If your heart is wise.
Peach.
If you even think, they barely glanced at an attractive guy for a nanosecond. You can't take it. You are a hypocrite.
Well.
Amen.
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 Now, I didn't say your wife was lusted after another man. Mm-hmm. I said she saw a handsome man. Mm-hmm. How plain do I need to get?
Come on, talk to us.
If you are a man, you appreciate a nice looking woman who's attracted to you. A woman appreciates looking at an attractive, handsome, around 6'2" guy.
Shameless plug.
Still in good shape, though. I'm saying, bro, your wife is human.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Amen.
And she can look at an attractive man and not a woman. Unlike you who look at
me. Keep it real, Pastor. Keep it real. Honesty, integrity. Amen.
Tell the truth, Doctor. Come on.
Then in verse 9, the Lord informed these hypocrite Pharisees that the original plan and intent of God was marriage was never for a man to get rid of his wife anytime he wanted. Most likely to get a newer and a younger model. But for a man and a wife to stay together until death separates them. Amen. The Lord quotes Genesis, but from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. But therefore God has joined together, let no man separate.
Amen.
This was a scathing attack against the Pharisees, for our Lord, through these words, revealed they, the Pharisees, were separating what God had joined together in violation of the command of God by twisting up the law to such an extent that you gave men any reason what they desire to get rid of their wives. And so he's letting them know, you have been leading people astray, because from the beginning it was not so. Right. Some of you are asking, what in the world was Jesus reprimanded the Pharisees on the subject of divorce have anything to do with the fact that Jesus believed in the miracles in the scriptures, which ordinarily are rejected by men? I know some of you wondering, how is he going to get there? Well, this episode has much to say about Jesus believing in the miracles in the scriptures.
Amen.
Because in this text, we see he believed in one of the greatest miracles of all.
Creation.
And that was the miracle of creation to the
omnipotent. Amen. Amen. Come on, Pastor.
Chapters 1 through 2.
Come on, Pastor.
What I'm saying is, in this confrontation with the Pharisees concerning divorce, we see that the Lord assumed, apart from any argument, that the creation in Genesis 1
was real.
2, it was literal, and it was real.
Amen. Come on. Go. Teach that word. Amen.
You know, I like this because you see what
Amen.
The God man
Amen.
Naturally
Amen.
Assume
about God's
to be true.
Come on. Great, Pastor.
You can see that he literally believed in the creation account in Genesis 1 through 2. And look, creation is one of the greatest miracles.
Amen.
Of
Hallelujah.
In this account, our Lord does not give a sophisticated argument or apologetic in an attempt to prove the creation account in the book of Genesis. He doesn't go into science, but we see how he believed in the creation account as a natural
Hallelujah.
Fact.
Amen.
To me, this is of a greater significance than a long, detailed attempt to prove the Genesis account of creation to be a literal fact. What we're seeing in these words, Marks 10:6-9, but the person who was perfect God and perfect man naturally believed to be true concerning the creation account
Amen.
In Genesis.
Amen.
That he believed in.
Amen.
Was literal.
Amen. Beautiful, Pastor. Well done. Amen.
And true.
Amen.
He doesn't quote this as his mythology.
Yeah.
He doesn't quote it as spiritual allegory. He doesn't quote it as metaphor. He doesn't quote it as a story made up by white men to keep black folks in line. Understand, that's the interpretation today. That Bible was white men. Keep up black. Look, when the Bible written, white folks weren't even around.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
Do you know that?
In Africa. Come on.
You know this came out of, we call it the Middle East. Romans call it Northeast Africa.
Amen.
Most of the Bible came out of the heart.
Come on. Come on, cut it straight.
So the white man didn't make it because he was still up in Great Britain worshiping dead ancestors. The Celtics and the Vikings and, see, we give you,
come on.
We need to teach this stuff. Amen. There was a time, amen, Europe was pagan.
Amen. Amen. Come on, tell the story.
Till God gave it to Paul, a man from Macedonia, said, hey, come over here and, yeah, help us.
Hallelujah.
And that's when God sent the, amen, Jew to, amen, evangelize, amen, right here.
Amen. The truth of Scripture, amen.
Don't tell us a white man. No. That's not true.
Amen. Amen.
All up in the house.
Come on.
You just a black folk want to be rebellious.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on. That's the truth.
You are convicted by the Scripture.
Yes.
You are convicted by,
yes,
Jesus.
Yes.
You know you're not right. You,
yes,
know you need to get right in your life.
Yes.
And your excuse is, it's a white man's book. If that's really what it is, why does it bother you so much?
Amen.
A lot of other white man books don't bother you.
Amen. Cut it straight. Come on. Cut it to the quick, Pastor
Wayne.
Come on.
And so you try,
beautiful, to pastor.
No, that's
beautiful.
A book for you.
Woo, hallelujah.
Pastor.
You get straight.
Amen. Amen.
With your God.
There's power in them words.
Listen to me finish.
Woo. Beautiful, pastor. Beautiful.
Notice the following. Now, verse 6, Jesus said, but from the beginning of creation. That's a direct allusion to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Lord did not leave the universe was eternal, or that matter is eternal. And somehow this impersonal matter that cannot think figured out a way to create an explosion. And then this impersonal matter, or impersonal force which cannot think, made a rational decision to find out a way to begin an evolutionary process, which took billions of years to produce a being as sophisticated as humans and an intricate, interdependent universe, an ecosystem, which is orderly, extremely orderly, in the most minute detail.
Amen.
The Lord believed all of creation, including the heavens and the earth, was a direct creation of God.
Amen.
If he didn't, it would have been ridiculous for him to appeal to this, to make these Pharisees get right with God.
Amen.
If this was myth, he never would have used it.
Amen.
Because we'd have had no authority over them. Mm-hmm. If I challenge you, you better do the right thing, lest Zeus is going to hit you with a thunderbolt. Are you worried?
Nope.
Because both you and I know Zeus do not exist.
Figment of our imagination.
He brings them back to Scripture.
Yes.
In the beginning, God said, not so. Because this is how God created the thing.
Yeah.
This is the third greatest miracle God ever did. He created the heavens and the earth. It was great because he spoke it out of nothing.
Amen.
Genesis 1:3, then God said, let there be light, and there was light. You know, there was a time when there was no such thing as physical light, but God spoke it into existence. Third greatest miracle God ever did was created the heavens and the earth. The second greatest miracle God did, he talks about that in the same verse. Mark 10:6, God made them male and female. That's a direct allusion to Genesis 1:27. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created a male and female. He created them.
Amen.
It did say he created them. I'm going to get in trouble today. It did not say he created them. LGBT. And now they got queer. Am I in the Bible?
Yes.
He made them male and female. God's creation of man, that's the second greatest miracle.
Yes.
Because he made man in his image.
Image.
Yes.
Come on, teach.
Breathe into him the breath of life, and man became
a living
soul. Genesis 2:7. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living soul. God created man in his image. man is a greater creation than the heavens and earth, because the heavens don't bear the image of God.
Amen.
Man does. Amen. What bears the image of God is greater than what that does, that does, that which does not bear
Amen.
The image of God.
Amen.
No matter how messed up you are, you bear the image of God. Amen.
Amen. Come on, Pastor. Good word.
The earth doesn't bear the image of God. Space and stars don't bear the image of God. You do.
Yes.
Second greatest thing God ever did was made you.
Beautiful.
The first greatest miracle is God became a man.
Amen.
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 In the person of Christ.
Yes.
Yes.
And dwelled and walked among men.
Hallelujah.
And died for them.
Yes.
Amen.
In order to pay the price for their dirt.
Yes.
Yes. Sin.
Yes.
Was buried. And rose again.
Powerful.
He forever became a man, but never ceased to be God, just to save you. And he is forever the God-man. The greatest miracle God ever did is he became a man, and he's forever a man, but he never ceased to be God. And he did it just to save you. That's the greatest miracle.
Amen.
Well, if God could create the universe out of nothing and create man out of dirt and gold, and man becomes a living soul, the rest of the miracles in the Bible for God is duck soup.
Amen.
It's nothing. If God can make the universe out of nothing, speaking into existence by his word, form some dust, breathe on it, and man becomes a living soul. The other miracles in the Bible are completely valid. If God could create light out of nothing by speaking into existence, then it is no great thing that God could make a donkey speak, as it did in Numbers 22:28. And the Lord opened the mouth of the donkey, and she said to Balaam, "What have I done that you have struck me?" These are not going, here we go. Well, donkeys don't have vocal cords, they can't speak. We're talking about God.
Amen. Amen. He can do anything.
God spoke the universe out of nothing. For him to make a donkey speak is nothing. If God can make man from the dust of the ground in his own image, God certainly couldn't raise a man from the dead. Luke 7:11-16, soon afterwards he went to the town called Nain, and his disciples and a great crowd with him. As he drew near to the gate of the town, behold, a man who had died was being carried out. The only son of his mother, she was a widow, and a considerable crowd from town was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said to her, "Do not weep." Then he came up and touched the bier, the coffin, and the bier stood still, the pallbearer stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say to you, arise." And the dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave it to his mother, and fear seized them all. I guess so, amen. If God can make you out of dust and go, and you're a living soul, what is raising the dead to God? If God can make the universe out of nothing, what is it to God to bring about a flood and destroy everything? If creation is true, the rest of the miracles are true. Because God made it so. This is what the God-men believed about the miracles in the Bible. Jesus believed in the flood from the days of Noah. Luke 17:26-27, the Lord says, "And just as it happened in the days of Noah, it will be also in the days of the Son of Man. They were eating, they were drinking, they were marrying, they were being given in marriage to the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all." The Lord says, the same way folks got caught up during Noah's day, and the flood came, and nobody knew anything about it, just another day doing their own thing. He said, the same thing going to happen right before I come back. It's just going to be another day, and you're going to be doing your own thing. Everybody going to be doing their own thing, whatever that thing is. And the trumpet shall sound. Mm-hmm. Jesus believed God burned Sodom and Gomorrah to an ash heap.
Yeah.
Luke 17:28-19, it was the same as happened in the days of Lot. They were eating, they were drinking, they were buying, and they were selling, they were planting and were building. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom and rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed all of them, he believed God killed up everybody in Sodom and Gomorrah. The Lord believed what no scientific person believes today, that he turned Lot's wife into a pillar of salt.
Amen.
Genesis 19:20 says, but his wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. Remember the background. God sent two angels to the city, told Lot, get your whole family to get out of here. I'm fixing to burn this whole thing to the ground. And he said, when you leave, don't look back. And they all was leaving. His wife said, I got to take one more peek because my heart is in Sodom. Somebody wrote a song. I left my heart in San Francisco. High on the hill is calling out to. Her heart was still in Sodom. She got to get one more peek. She disobeyed God. And God turned her to a rock of salt.
Amen.
In Luke 17:32, the Lord said, remember Lot's wife. Jesus believed in the incident in the wilderness. And the Hebrews were rebellious once again, and God sent a bunch of snakes and bit a bunch of them up, and they got dead. And he told Moses, make a bronze serpent, and whoever looks up at it will live. Numbers 21:19, and Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a stand, and it came about that if the serpent bit any man, when he looked up to the bronze serpent, he lived. The Lord believed that actually occurred because he says in John 3:14, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. Just as they looked up at that bronze serpent that they've been bit by that snake and live, you've been bit by the devil, the real snake, amen?
Amen.
And if you look up to Jesus, God says, you will live. Amen. They were rebellious, so God sent some snakes, was killing a bunch of them. And God said, put a serpent up on a pole, and when you look up to it, you'll live. Well, you've been bit by the devil if you don't know the Lord. And he said, light by the Son of Man will be lifted up, that whoever trusts in him, they will have eternal life.
Yes!
Now, I'm going one more fish. The Lord really believed John was swallowed by a fish.
Amen.
According to the scripture, Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights.
Yeah.
The fish vomited Jonah up on the shore, and he lived to preach another day. Hmm. You can read all that in Jonah 1:17 through Jonah 2:10. But our Lord believed that was true. Matthew 12:38-40. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, teacher, we want to see a sign from you. But he answered and said to them, and even an adulterous generation craved a sign. 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. In these verses, our Lord said, just as Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, he said he would be in the ground dead 3 days, three nights. If the account in Jonah is symbolic or allegory, then we can also see Jesus' death and resurrection in the same allegory. It's not true. For Jesus' body rose from the dead after the third day in the grave. Yes. And Jonah's experience was similar because he was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the fish. And so the Lord likens his physical resurrection to Jonah physically being in that fish for 3 days and three nights. I can give you many more examples of the fact that our Lord Jesus Christ believed in the miracles that are recorded in the scriptures. If you give some serious thought to it, should not things like that be recorded in the book that comes from God?
Yes.
If a book really comes from God, don't you expect the miraculous to be in that book? Don't you expect God to show up and do things man can't do and things that are impossible? Man, this is the Word of God. Wouldn't you expect it to bear traits of the God who can do all things?
Amen.
The miracles are in the Bible. They are consistent with the nature of God. It is important for those of us who are orthodox in the faith that we believe in the miracles recorded in the scripture.
Yes.
Two reasons. It is important because if Jesus believed in them, so should we.
Amen.
And the second reason,
Amen.
Because he's a miracle working God. Lord, I praise you and thank you for all things today. Lord, I really pray that through this incident between the Pharisees and Jesus, that we can see that the Lord believe in one of the greatest miracles ever to occur, that of creation. And if God could create everything from nothing by speaking into existence, the rest of the miracles recorded in the Bible, they are nothing with God. Lord, help us to understand the Lord, believe in the miracles in the Bible. And so should we. Because we want to follow the footsteps of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And then maybe there's someone today who are not saved. You do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior. None of us know where eternity is going to find us. Wherever eternity finds you, it'll keep you there. Mm-hmm. If you die and don't know Jesus Christ, there are no second chances. Nobody can pray you out. No one can buy any indulgences and get you out. Your eternal destiny will be set. If you don't know Jesus Christ, it'll be an eternity in the place Jesus likened to a furnace of fire, or a place where there's weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. And the only way of escape is Jesus. Became a man, died for your sins, buried, and rose again. Trusted him, and God will save you. There is one today, and God, the Holy Spirit, is nudging you to give your life to Jesus Christ. Is there one today? Would you just raise your hand and let me dissolve the workers pray with you? Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, convict those who are not saved of their sin and their need of Jesus Christ. Don't let them sleep. Lord, convict them in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for every need that exists today. Pray for Sister Pat, Sister Perry, Sister Sonia, death of a close loved one. And I believe she died in Sister Pat's home, so pray for her. Lord, let us respond and rally around them and support them as they need support during this trying time. Lord, I pray for our country, pray for our land, pray for protection of our children. Lord, we look up to you for all things. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Can you say amen?